So thank you for joining us today. Just to introduce me, I'm Scott Alford. I head up business development on the planning portal. And I'm joined by my colleague here today, Earl Hamilton, who heads up our design at our parent company, TerraQuest. So we do a lot of work together on all of the products that we work on here at Planning Portal and TerraQuest. It's been a while since our last series of kind of show and tells to you guys, the digital future of planning and building, when we were replatforming the Planning Portal service, which was last January. We're continuing with that vision with ongoing improvements to our service, and that's to meet our vision of transforming planning and building control. Today's agenda, we're going to talk back what we've been doing in the last 12 months. We've bedded in the new service that has provided the foundations for the further digital service improvement. And thanks to everybody for your support during the implementation of that new service last year. Since then, we've kicked on with some very important changes. So a quick recap, as you may have missed some of those key features that we've delivered in the last 12 months. And then for 2023, we've got, working with our TerraQuest solutions colleagues, we have some very exciting new improvements planned, and I'll give you a high-level overview of those. The new platform, as you know, was developed to be more spatial, and that was to deliver the digital improvements across planning and building. The first key start, the first key milestone of this for 2023 is a new location plan feature, and that's integrated within the site location plan process, but we will give you a demonstration of that in a bit. So let me just flash up this slide here. One year on, we have also been supporting this with our marketing, so you may have seen some of these messages come out to you. They are available via our director's blog as well. But if we just look back over the last 12 months on some of the key things that we have been implementing on the planning portal, I will share these slides afterwards so that you can have a look in a little bit more detail. But for me, there's some real good key milestones and deliverables in there. The 12 new prior approvals are now online, and local authorities can receive those into their back office system. So all that information has been communicated out to the ICT suppliers. On building the new infrastructure, there's been lots of system improvements around the infrastructure to enable that greater resilience and robustness of our service. Other enhancements to supporting documents upload and document naming. So those have been introduced, along with local authorities now having a file upload capacity that they can change to support up to individual files being uploaded to around 30 megabytes. We've also introduced the new use class categories. So you would have seen those, category E and category F. They're now available on the appropriate forms. And one for me that I know I've been pestered about over the last 20 years, you've now got, as an applicant or an agent, you've got the ability to copy across application types. So if you created an outline application, you can then carry across that data into, reserved matters. You can carry that information across into an outline application as well. This is all, you know, the copy facility is the first step. It's really important that we've now got that level of functionality in building that planning and building ecosystem. But that will allow us a bit further down the line to join up our services better between the planning application submission facility and then creating a building control service with a single sign-on to be able to do that. So lots of stuff have been going on in the last 12 months. And then when we look at our roadmap, so we're here today to give you an overview of our new location plan feature. We've then got some improvements around the way in which the technology, modernizing it, the way we share data with local authorities and their back office systems, improvements to amendments, and then we've got just down the bottom supporting document improvements too. But just looking at the new connectors. It is using a modern standard to communicate that information. It's called JSON by the technical guys, and we need to transition across. But there are many advantages to that, that we can develop potentially a two-way integration with other systems. So getting back onto the invalidation for amendments, you know, if we have two-way connectors in place, there is the ability to share the reasons why with applicants as to why it may be incomplete, and then we can get those amendments coming back through the planning portal system. So it really starts to join up and make that a two-way function, which at the moment we just pass the data through to the local authorities, it populates your back office system, so it will make that a lot more intuitive. And with regards to amendments, I know local authorities only want to see the new data, so our solutions team are looking into that. They're doing discovery around that and looking to set the requirements to develop that. We know that applicants and agents like that feature because it gives you the option to have that quality control and that audit of your applications from when they were submitted and when they were amended, and that is all recorded in the system. And that's not forgetting about, we haven't got it on this slide, but we've started a process of discovery on the building control service as well. So replatforming that onto the same platform as planning. The engagement has started with applicants, agents, and building control bodies. And we want your feedback on the new service design and delivery for that. So capturing the challenges and the wants and the needs to be able to make that improvement. So if you want to get involved in that, by all means, do give us a shout and we can have that discussion. So as you can see, the roadmap for this year is looking quite busy with all those improvements. Now on to the site location plan feature. You may have seen the videos that we've sent out around this. But just to give you an overview, you know, what is it and why are we doing it? Well, you know, the location plan feature is all about how you identify the sites on the planning portal, which will change when we introduce this. So instead of plotting your red line boundary externally to the planning portal on a separate maybe mapping facility, you will get the option to draw that on the planning portal. So identify your location, you can come in and then you'll be able to snap those points around the location and capture that red line boundary. We're planning on introducing that around May this year. But why are we doing it? So there are multiple reasons as to why we're doing it. Supporting the government's digital planning reforms, reducing invalidation, but equally improving efficiency and having a consistent approach. So a key part of what we do is the ongoing development of the planning portal, but a key focus is always around the invalidation of plan and applications and how we might be able to technically work across all of the stakeholders within it to make those improvements. So what do the government say? So when reviewing the digital planning agenda of government, what are they saying? So again, what I've done here is just to highlight some of the processing provision of planning data that they would like to see. So they want to set more data standards, which you will be aware of. Data being held consistently and being able to transmit that across different parties. They want it provided digitally, approved data standards. So all of these things are key within the government and what they want to achieve through planning, but also making information publicly available is a key part of that as well. So making certain, again, achieving data standards, making it available consistently, all of that fits in with our new feature for creating location plans directly on the planning portal. As a part of delivering the service, we've gone through a discovery phase. And again, that is a joined up approach between planning portal and TerraQuest to do that. So in the discovery, well, what was the brief that we were working to? Identifying the issues and opportunities relating to the creation and submission of location plans as part of the application submission process. So we've got on here some of the things about what we did in terms of those interviews with those key stakeholders, agents, architects and suppliers, data analysts on portal applications, Looking into the functionality and cost. So, you know, how a key part of this is how do we do that consistently? So we've partnered up to use Ordnance Survey as the key base mapping for that to make all of this happen. And again, feeding back what we learned. The invalidation of applications still remains a major issue for planning, with around 50% of applications still being invalid. The payment service that we put in place in 2018 has done a lot to improve that, but there's still quite a lot to be done. And around location plan, we know that there is still a high percentage that's invalid because of that reason. So we then looked at, you know, what is the as-is process? So put ourselves in the shoes of a planning agent. And again, you can see when they come on to make an application, they have to source the plan separately to the planning portal. It is more of a document. So they go on and they mark those points and plot those locations, come onto the planning portal, complete their application, and then they upload it and submit it. When that goes in through to a local authority, they receive all that information into their back office system. But then they get that plan and they replot the location into their GIS systems. So again, there's a lot of duplication there that we think if that gets done at the front end of the process, and then we can pass that file through and support it and make it more efficient. Then looking at the as is and then the 2B, we can then see here that it allows you, we will be creating a facility to go on. You'll still be able to put in your postcode and we'll demonstrate that. But at that point, you'll be able to snap that polygon into the system and again, identify that site and go through the usual process that you would in completing the forms, uploading additional attachments and getting that off to the local authority. And then on the backside, when that goes into the local authority systems, they will then be able to use that file to ingest that data constraint layer. Again, being spatial, where we want to get to in the future with Deluxe Digital database, a digital land database. Again, being spatial, hopefully in the future, we'll be able to pick up those land constraint layers and designations and be able to identify how that fits in with this digital site location plan being provided as well. So on looking at the efficiencies that we anticipate from those two processes, a simplified creation process, including the option to autofill. So you'll be able to snap a polygon around a property and it will draw that red line and autofill. So that will be quick and easy. You'll also get a PDF attachment will be created as we transition across. So, you know, there is a bit of a process change. So the local authorities will still get a PDF document, as will the applicants, but we will send a data file with that as well. Looking at the invalidation of location plans, we hear around 22% from the REAPA project, and the research have shown that. But equally from TerraQuest in managing planning applications online, we can see that that still remains quite a big issue with the receipt of those location plans. So that should go away with, you know, not worrying about the direction north and license plan. All of that begins to be removed. Again, I've touched on the ability to ingest the information into the local authorities' back office systems. And again, it's then automatically available on the local authorities' planning registers. So a lot of integration going on there to simplify that process. So just going on to the location plan feature, I'll now stop sharing and hand over to my colleagues. What you've been waiting for, to kind of show and tell, to see what that's going to look like. We can show you that now.
So what I've got here is a prototype, essentially. So the features are all currently in development. And what I will walk through is almost like a dummy version to the designs that we hand over that will be developed by our development team. So I'm going to demo here. As you'll see, those of you familiar with the portal, not too much will change when you start creating an application. You'll give it a name, as you always have. You'll find your site location via postcode. And you will confirm what type of application you'd like to apply for. So that all remains as is. Where things begin to get different is here, where we're going to ask you to provide a site boundary. Now, we're giving you three options at this point, where you can draw the site boundary. You can upload a geospatial file. So some of you may be using your own software to plot site ranges as part of your normal working, and you can export those files and upload those into our system. And I'll show you that in a second. So first of all, to draw a site boundary, there's some onboarding screens just for the range of different users we have, which can be skipped. But for those new users to the portal who have no idea what a site boundary is, we're trying to keep those engaged as well as, the regular user. So I'll skip past those for now. But essentially, this is the postcode that I've put in. And I'm going to plot my site boundary. We've got two means to do this. We can use the autofill tool, which will pick up on the layers within the ordnance survey map to identify what is clickable as a boundary. And I could identify that boundary. The system will tell me that I've successfully identified my red light boundary and that I can now proceed. So this is the simplest journey that I'm going to show you. So I'll just whiz through this. So we'll get our check your answers page as you always have, confirming everything you've put in, including the fact you provided a single site boundary. And then we can create our application. What I'm going to do is jump back here and show you the freehand version. So if I'm going to draw my site boundary again, I can select the freehand tool. And this can allow me to plot the boundary in a more freehand fashion, assuming it's not just a rectangle, for example, that I'm showing you here. So for more complex shapes where you need to go outside of what the snapping tool might provide you, we offer you that functionality. You can also undo and reset all of your boundaries as well. So you're not trapped in, you can make amendments as you go. You can also, which isn't included in this demo, edit the shape once it's been created with the freehand tool. So if I wanted to add more points, drag a point out to a corner, remove a point, those are all features that are available during freehand drawing. So again, we get to the same journey where you can check all your answers. We tell you that you've got a site boundary and you've created your application. An important thing to note as well on the application overview is the fact that we replay back to you the boundary you've plotted. There is the opportunity to re-edit the boundary once the application has been created. But again, I'm going to jump back and show you the upload. So I've got a file that I want to upload. I won't be plotting. I select my file. It's uploaded to the system. And then I can begin to identify these boundaries. So as you can see, it's brought in the geospatial data and placed it into the map. And what we can do is then choose what I'm going to identify first of all, a red or a blue line. So I can identify my red line, and then any additional properties, as we know that sometimes need to be identified, we can do that also. So as you can see now, I've got my two polygons identified, and we can continue. If for some reason we reach this point and we're not happy and we want to upload a new file, you're not trapped in again, you can either go back or you can jump straight into uploading a new file from here. Again, presented with the same information, but here, as you'll see now, we have one additional property that's been identified. So we're replaying back to the users constantly what they've plotted. And again, this is replayed to us here and throughout. And finally, well, not quite finally, there's two things I'm going to show you here. So I'm going to plot the boundary again using the autofill quite quickly, as we've seen, because I'm also conscious of time. Create our application, and now I'm going to show how we create the location plan. So we're now into our created application. Again, we're being replayed all the information that pertains to this application, so the local authority, the address that I've put in, the Eastern and Northern. Here you can see if I've made some fundamental mistake in the plotting my boundary or I've received new information, I can go back and address that, and I haven't got that to show you here, but essentially you can do this via a few ways. You can reset your boundary choice. So if you now want to upload rather than draw, you can do that. So you're not trapped into the way you created your boundary either. But what I want to actually show you is the reviewing of a location plan. So we will show you your location plan. This is slightly out of date in terms of what the final template for a location plan looks like, but it does contain all the information, and this can be expanded to be viewed larger so you can actually inspect the detail. We check that you've met the criteria for a location plan. As you can see, there's not two road names. So what this gives me the opportunity to do is identify a road name if the road is visible, but the name isn't. And I can pop in that road name, it will appear. I can set the angle so it doesn't look a bit skew-iff as it did there, and save that. And then we've got our completed location plan. I'm happy with that. I can proceed to confirm, and we sign the declaration to say that we're happy with the location plan that we're providing and we're comfortable with it, and we can complete, and we can see that that as a part of our application, that step has been completed, and we can proceed with all the other steps of the application.
Yeah, thank you for that, Errol. That's a nice quick show and tell of what we've got there. I have had a couple of questions from a local authority that couldn't attend today. One is, you know, how do they ingest that red line boundary when it comes in? You know, we do send you a package of that information digitally. Your ICT supplier comes in and picks that up. Now, on talking to some of the ICT suppliers, they have ability to import that into your GIS software that then links to your public access systems. For some, it will be you know, might be able to turn it on pretty quickly, but we are aware that others may need to do a little bit of development just to get that transition of that document through, as you would with, you know, supporting documents, entering a document management system. Really, they need to identify the file and then they need to get that put into the appropriate system to be displayed. For applicants and agents, you've probably already seen that a lot of local authorities on their public registers, they do have a map function on there now that allows you to go in and view that property location plan. Again, the benefit of that is that you can zoom in and zoom out, taking away all of these invalidation issues that could be related to not having the direction north or not having two features on the plan to be able to identify it. So that will go away. And, you know, me thinking longer term, we do get a high rate of invalidation. Well, if local authorities are receiving this property extent file, they will be able to go in and edit that file to ensure that that's right. And as a part of the validation process, they can then confirm that to the applicant and agent as part of the registration validation. So it is something that we are working with many different parties to deliver, but we do see quite a lot of efficiencies coming about with this. We also have had some agents say, can I have access to that, that boundary line? So following submission, they can actually download that polygon. And if they've got their own systems in which they're recording applications, then they can access that file and they can plot it back into their own systems as well. So it can be shared both ways in that respect. Is there an additional fee for using the map feature from the planning portal? Obviously, in the development of this, there will be a fee. We, in order to do this on a national level, you need to use software that is interoperable both for applicants and agents, but can be successfully received by the local authorities. So we're using Ordnance Survey to be able to do that, and they've got the government agreement with local authorities. So there will be a fee, and we will be communicating more about that. We will include that fee as a part of the service charge. Will it populate the site area and link to fee based on area plotted? No, it won't do that at the moment. It is more of a standalone location plan feature. But again, thinking future proofing, if we can see the area size, then there's lots of value to be able to start looking into that as well. Question from Catherine. Will the PDF of the location plan be available before the application is submitted? Yes, it will. So I think Earl touched on that in his demonstration. So once the boundary line has been drawn, it does create a location plan. And I believe that will sit in the supporting documents section of an applicant's application.
Yes, but it will be downloadable post-submission.
Okay.
So yeah, it populates the supporting documents section. So where you are, one of your mandatory documents is a location plan. It replaces that as a mandatory document because the system knows that it's been populated using the portal.
Will this process work for the generation of a mineral and extraction site, for example, which could be in excess of 10 hectares? That is a very large file. So we can cater for certain map sizes, and I believe, Earl, we can go up to 1 to 2500 on identifying the site. I think on something like that, of that size, then hopefully the agent will have the ability to get that file, and they'll be able to upload that and share that. And obviously, once that integration's there, you should be able to receive that into the back office system. What about the interpretation of the site boundary? Does it include full access and visibility splays? Not sure that it will. What Earl demonstrated there was to mark up those red and blue line polygons of ownership and other land that is identified. It will be those two kind of shape files, those polygon files, which will be passed through to the local authority. Obviously, if that's ingested by the local authority's back office system and they present that on their own mapping software, then it gives that full ability to zoom in and zoom out, and you can look at it to whatever extent you may need.
So, can I just add to that, Scott, as well? Obviously, this is where, I suppose, the continuous improvement and learning comes in as well, isn't it? If we need to consider other shapes and stuff being able to be drawn in the tool, that's the kind of thing that we want to understand over the months after it's launched.
Yeah. What happens if the site outline is done wrong? Can the applicant redo it and resubmit it? So, yeah, Earl's nodding there. We do have the ability on the amendment facility. So if you amended an application, it will give you the functionality to go back in, edit that, resubmit, and obviously local authorities will get that updated file coming through. What about block plans as part of the submission process? Again, I think a block plan is a bit of an extension to what we're doing here around the location plan. As Earl mentioned, there is the ability to include lots of different features as well. But initially, we will look at getting the location plan out, getting those red and blue lines captured and transferred through to local authorities and getting that used successfully. With our own tool, we had request a plan, and that had the ability to also do block plans. So certainly it's using that ordnance survey base map and being able to share with local authorities, that is something that we can look into as a future enhancement. As a part of its introduction, we will be holding another show and tell on the 27th of April. So we'll invite all of you guys back, and that will be a full walkthrough of the product that we'll be going live with. We have got experience of doing this location plan feature before. We rolled out the Northern Ireland application service towards the end of 2022 last year. And we've had some good feedback from the applicants and agents on using this facility. And it's very much how Earl demonstrated, that you pop in your postcode and then you can plot that site location. So, you know, if you want to dummy run it and go and create a test application on Northern Ireland, you will see bits and pieces of it there. But, you know, do hang on, and we'll be back on the 27th to be able to show you a little bit more about that as well. Okay. And just to close, any questions that you might have post this event, send them through to communications@planningportal.co.uk, and we'll be sure to pick them up. Keep watching the Planning Portal's blog, because that's where we'll push out more information around this service. And again, if your colleagues want to have a look at a short video clip of some of the stuff that we've covered today, again, that is already on the blog. Okay. Thank you for joining us today, and we hope to speak to you shortly.
Thanks, everyone.